On the last episode of Worn Out, I took a look through my closet and found out a lot of my wardrobe is made of oil. But while I was in there, I also realized that I've got a lot of clothes I don't wear anymore. It got me thinking about what options we have to get rid of old clothes. When you put clothes straight into the trash, they usually end up in a landfill or an incinerator. Bad news for the environment. US landfills are responsible for almost a fifth of the country's methane emissions. That's a greenhouse gas, which is 80 times more planet warming than carbon in the short term. When polyester clothes end up in landfills, they act like any other kind of plastic. They don't break down easily. It can take polyester up to 200 years to decompose, creating the need for more landfills and then creating more methane emissions. Trash clothes that don't go to landfills usually go to trash incinerators, where they get burned up, creating another environmental disaster. Yes, all that burned stuff can be used to generate energy, but it comes at a huge cost. Incinerators emit more carbon dioxide per unit of electricity than even coal plants. Both incinerators and landfills also create other pollutants that have been linked to increased rates of various kinds of cancers and asthma, and they're often built in poor Black and brown communities. I figured there must be other ways to get rid of clothes that don't contribute to this cycle. Like, what about donation? But the question is, what actually happens to clothes when you drop them off at the donation site? Adam Minter literally wrote the book on that. His most recent book is Secondhand: Travels in the New Global Garage Sale. So what happens to clothing when we're done with it here in the US?
When you donate it to someone, they have an immediate incentive to find somebody who wants to buy it and reuse it. You know, on average, about one third of the apparel that is put out in a thrift store sells on the racks of that thrift store. But that doesn't mean that it's then, okay, that one third doesn't, only that two thirds doesn't sell, it's going to the incinerator.
Adam has reported extensively on the global markets of reused clothing. For decades, many of the clothes that we've tossed into Salvation Army or Goodwill donation boxes have gone into this vast global network where traders from around the world would collect the clothes, grade their condition, and transport them around the world to be recycled or worn again or turned into rags and stuffing.
There is a range of international buyers who want that stuff to sell into their home countries. And so much of it goes into the export market. It's a really fascinating system. Say a thrift store simply couldn't sell what was given to it. They will pack it up into bales, literally like a hay bale of clothes. These are giant, giant facilities that can go through hundreds of thousands of pounds of clothing in a day.
So Adam, how much clothing from the Americas is actually winding up in these export markets overseas? Could you talk a little bit about that?
One of the great challenges I've had in reporting on this trade is actually finding quality data on what the volumes are. But secondhand clothes is very challenging. One, it's just not a priority for most governments to track the secondhand market in anything. Clothes, computers, water bottles, whatever it is. There is a certain amount of mystery surrounding it.
Since there's so little data on these markets, it's really hard to know what their environmental impact is. We don't know how much carbon is created by, for instance, transporting all these clothes overseas. But we do know that these secondhand markets extend the life of clothes. And from an environmental perspective, that's certainly better than throwing them out. Adam, though, has found that in recent years, because the fashion industry is producing so many more clothes, this whole system isn't able to handle them. The fashion industry now produces 150 billion items every year, which is 20 items per person on Earth. It's not just the actual discarded garments that are an issue either. The industry also wastes a ton of fabric in its production cycles. To learn more about that issue, I called up Jessica Schreiber. She's the founder of a New York City nonprofit called FabScrap. But before she did that, she worked on managing textile waste for the New York City Department of Sanitation.
When we talk about textile waste, how big a problem is this in New York City and throughout the United States?
One of the stats that we use a lot at sanitation is that textile waste makes up 6% of New York City waste. And that doesn't sound like that much, but it's the next biggest waste stream after you take out traditional recyclables and after you take out compostable food. The next big piece of the pie that has to be addressed is textile waste.
Jessica said this whole wasteful production scheme is what inspired her to start FabScrap. The nonprofit collects unused materials from 500 brands, including major ones.
So the vast majority of what we're picking up are fabric swatches. We're also seeing some cutting room scraps. So you've decided on your fabric and now you're cutting a pattern. There's all those cookie cutter edges left over. We see a lot of that. A lot of times mills will have a purchasing minimum, meaning that they will only make enough so that the brand has a minimum to purchase to be able to get the fabric that they want. And that means that brands overbuy, and therefore there's a lot of dead stock and excess. And so that we pick up by the roll, hundreds of thousands of rolls of fabric every year.
Jessica knows she can't take on this huge problem of fabric waste all by herself.
Textile waste has been handled by nonprofit. And so it's kind of been a little bit of a band-aid or a get out of jail free card. The nonprofits have kind of become this waste management system that they're not really that established for because of how quickly this waste stream has grown and how little of the clothing is really reusable and resellable anymore.
Governments could also boost clothing recycling, which would involve changing what we make clothes out of. As we learned in the first episode of Worn Out, lots of clothes are made of a blend of materials, like a pair of cotton denim with 2% spandex in it. And then there's the problem of making garments by attaching a whole bunch of different kinds of materials together. In 2018, the US recycled less than 15% of all textile waste.
Shoes are notoriously hard to recycle because they're all glued and sewn together, really, really hard to deconstruct. And so while the material choice is a component and wanting things to be more recyclable, thinking about the garment overall and how long it lasts, how long it would take to decompose, I think just thinking about end of life at the beginning is really important.
Since mixed materials are basically impossible to recycle, they end up in landfills and incinerators.
A key component of recycling and waste diversion is being able to efficiently sort the waste stream. And if you have infinity versions of blends, there's no way to sort that in a great way. And so by limiting the number of blends or the number of fibers that are used in the majority of clothing, it does make the waste stream more consistent and more recyclable.
Officials could also consider implementing durability standards that would basically ensure that clothing is built to last. France has done this for appliances. Why can't we do it for clothing too? There's individual ways we can help with all this too, like by repairing our clothes when they get ripped or torn instead of just throwing them out and replacing them. Or when we're sick of everything in our wardrobes, we could consider having clothing swaps with our friends. On a personal level, maybe the best way to deal with clothing waste is to change how we buy in the first place. That's what we're gonna get into on the next episode of Worn Out.